Good morning. It's the first time I've said that. I usually say good afternoon, but good morning. It's Dr. Nick Coatsworth with today's top three. And today's shout out is to our allied health professionals, our physiotherapists, our dietitians, our occupational therapists and social workers, podiatrists. There's so many of you out there and you're doing such a great job during COVID-19. And what I want to say is for patients out there who have an allied health professional, don't be afraid to go to their places of practice, because I know that they've been putting in place processes that are going to keep you safe during this COVID-19 epidemic. And it's more important now that you get your treatment for those chronic conditions that you need, and you will be safe going to those practices. So always call ahead just to make sure that they're happy. They'll probably have processes in place to make sure there's not too many people in the waiting room, for example. And of course, if you're at all unwell with any of those respiratory symptoms that we speak about, make sure you contact your GP and get tested for COVID-19.
First question for Dr. Nick. Will COVID-19 ever be fully eradicated in Australia?
So this is a really important question at the moment, particularly when you see on the news there's so many questions about borders internally in Australia. So let's go through these concepts of eradication, elimination and suppression, because they're all slightly different in health terms. For those of you, and I'm not old enough to remember this, but obviously as an infectious disease physician, I've looked at it. But for those of you who are old enough to remember smallpox was a condition, in fact, the condition in the 20th century that we were able to eradicate with a vaccine. So eradicate means it's just not here anymore in the world, probably sitting in a couple of labs somewhere, but it's certainly not circulating in any communities in the world. And we're trying to do the same with polio, been sort of less successful with that. But both were eradicated because they had very effective vaccines, and they were so effective that they actually stopped the transmission within the world community. Elimination is a different concept. Elimination means that the virus is not within a defined geographic area. It's still in the world, but it's been eliminated from a geographic area. Now, this might sound like a very attractive proposition for Australia. We are an island. We can strongly regulate who's coming in and out. And that has been successful, closing the international borders in terms of stopping spread into Australia. But then you've got to kind of look at what is the impact on society of those measures that you are going to take to actually eliminate it? And then you've got to consider, is this virus actually going to be hanging around for so long that elimination, whilst it might be an attractive idea, is a completely impractical idea, because it would mean we'd have to close our borders in perpetuity. Suppression is the concept that we have advocated at the Australian Department of Health and the Australian Health Protection Principle Committee. That is, that you have such an effective public health response with great disease detectives who are able to jump on these cases and work out who the contacts have been of the patients who are COVID-19 positive. We have an excellent testing regime where you have tens of thousands of tests being done every week to try and find COVID-19, and we have a very strong healthcare system. So it means that we can live with cases. And for those of you who are living in states where there are very few or zero cases at the moment, that is not a sufficient reason to say we are going to eliminate this virus from our state. Because that would mean that you can't visit anywhere else in Australia. I think it is unlikely that we're going to get elimination in this continent, the continent of Australia. Then we need to move on to the, well, if we're not going to get elimination, we're just going to suppress this virus. What about the vaccine? Is that going to lead us to elimination? And again, it's really difficult sitting in this seat, because I have to say it depends. It depends, firstly, if we get a safe and effective vaccine. And even if we do, that's about 12 to 18 months away. Secondly, it depends, well, how effective is that vaccine? Is this going to be like the TB vaccine, which just stops severe illness in young children? Is it going to be like the influenza vaccine, which is good at decreasing the burden of influenza every year in the community, but is only between 30 to 60% effective? Or is it going to be like the smallpox or the polio vaccine, where you can actually hope for worldwide eradication? I don't think it's going to be the latter. I think it's probably going to be something like the influenza vaccine. So we need to prepare ourselves that COVID-19 may become what we call an endemic, that means it circulates within the global community, it might just become another coronavirus that can make us unwell, just like coronaviruses, other coronaviruses can at the moment. So for all those reasons, I think we need to be very careful when we talk about elimination versus suppression in Australia, because the consequences for our social and economic, our mental health, all those sort of things that are affected by locking down are magnified if we go for an elimination strategy. So that is why the national strategy has been suppression. And I think our goal should be to have just restricted geographic clusters that are jumped on very quickly, a bit like in bushfire season when we would put out a spot fire. And that's why we've recommended that sort of approach. It's taken a little while to answer that question, but I think it was worth it.
Second question. Can vitamin supplements improve the body's response to COVID-19?
Well, this one's going to be a little bit quicker. It is an attractive option to be able to take vitamins and feel as though they might be giving a bit of an extra boost to the immune system. The reality is that anything you buy as a supplement from a vitamin perspective is many times, thousands, tens of thousands of times in excess of what your body needs. And most of it, once you put it in, it just gets put straight out again, either when you go to the toilet, or it gets metabolized. So, you know, the vitamins that you need for a functioning immune system are obtained from a healthy, balanced diet. And so there's so many other reasons to have a healthy, balanced diet, low cholesterol amongst one of them, that, you know, if you really want to have good vitamins, enough vitamins, just to have a balanced diet with lots of fresh fruit and veggies, and that'll be right. There are some notable exceptions, though, and you will see that a lot of our cereals have folate supplementation and that we encourage folate use in early pregnancy. That has specifically been shown to help with something called neural tube defects or spina bifida. So there are specific instances where vitamins can be a good idea. But things like high dose vitamin C for respiratory infections, not a particularly good use of your money, I have to say.
Last question for today. How effective are alcohol-based hand sanitizers in killing viruses?
So I'm really glad this question has come up because like every sort of treatment for COVID-19 or possible mitigating risk factor, not all alcohol-based hand sanitizers are equal. It depends on what's actually in them, and how effective that is killing viruses depends on having a certain amount of alcohol within them. So it needs to be at least 60% to be effective at killing COVID-19. Now, there's a very good section in the World Health Organization website that actually gives some recipes, and it talks about containing 80% ethanol or 75% isopropyl alcohol. So you can actually make this stuff. And I did go somewhere, I won't say exactly where, in Canberra that had made their own. It was potent and effective. It didn't exactly burn my hands, but it wasn't quite, the scent wasn't quite as good as the commercially made products. So you can make your own, but there's no shortage at the moment around. There's plenty in chemist warehouse and other chemists around the country where you can get your alcohol-based hand sanitizer. But if you're worried about whether it's, you know, the real deal, make sure you have a look at the label, because there's the TGA, the Therapeutic Goods Administration number on there, and it should have AUST, OST for Australia, and then it should have an R number. And so a number with the letter R in front of it. And that will tell you that it's actually been tested by the TGA. If it has an L number, that's slightly different. It hasn't had its ingredients tested, but it's still been passed through the TGA processes. So just make sure you have a look. You can see it. I think there's one on my hand sanitizer just on my desk. I checked it just then. So if you want to know if it's the real deal, that's the way. Finally, if you don't have hand sanitizer, soap and water, very effective. And for the kids out there, if you do the ABC rhyme, that happens to be 20 seconds. And that's the amount of time you need to really wash your hands to get rid of the virus. So that's so important, hand hygiene. It's one of the three things in the COVID-3 that we all have to do. Maintain good hand hygiene, keep our distance where we can, and download that app. I'll see you next week.